In this tutorial, I would like to give an overview of the new features in SwiftUI 3, also including which are available for 2 and which are always available, what changed for these two iteration cycles, because it's quite a lot of features they announced, especially if you want to support iOS 13. Things can get a little bit out of hand just because you have to always consider which features you can use for which version. So maybe that helps you to decide SwiftUI is a good choice for your next project, what it can do, and also specifically for the platform. So I did start already this roadmap, which I added a link in the description box so you can get the PDF. So I added here 2 different color highlights, one for which is yellow, that was already available for SwiftUI 2, I'm just calling it like this, which means that it's iOS 14 and macOS 11. And I didn't really, some of them are only available for one of them. Most of the time I try to highlight this. There's quite a few differences to tvOS and watchOS, which I didn't really take care of. So that you would need to check by yourself again. I'm just going to, in this tutorial, go through the new features and maybe even for some of the cases that I think are really, really cool, I will also have a short demo. There's going to be some parts that are more my personal opinion, and this is not a full list of everything, just trying to highlight the more important features, so it's a bit easier not to get lost. And since they're going to continue adding more, this is just going to get worse. Let's start by one of the biggest changes they did for SwiftUI 2, and this is the WindowGroup. They didn't change a lot this year. This feature is especially important if you are looking at making macOS app, because now you can do also the windows with SwiftUI. Or for example, you can now add a toolbar to your windows and also the menu. So this can be handled now with SwiftUI. One thing that is still missing is the window management. So you can not really, there's just one exception. If you have a list, 2 column with a navigation, you can double click on one of the items and it will open in a different window. If you really want to take advantage of creating programmatically opening windows, this is not supported. I am doing the WWDC. I had a SwiftUI lab and I asked an engineer, which was actually specifically for macOS, if you can do programmatically opening windows, and they said they don't currently support that. And I asked him about this. There is a workaround with on open URL and handle external events. And this is more for deep links or user activities. So for example, for state restoration, or somebody else sends a link and sends you to your app. But the way it's structured, it also works for creating windows. It's not the most straightforward way, but it does work. And with this, you can also manage to have different window types. We will see maybe next year they're going to add more stuff for macOS in this direction. In the view lifecycle, they added a new view modifier. So most of the time when a view appears, people start to load data. So it's connected to the lifecycle of this view. We now can use the task view modifier. And this is working with async, which means that it's really not only when this task not only starts when the view appears, it also stops when the view disappears. So it's a combination of these two lifecycle calls. Quite useful. For me, I'm not really sure about this one because I need to start learning async. And I prefer to, since I already know combine, to stick with combine. So now let's have a look at the tools we have to compose views. So the navigation views is one of the things that I think is still not optimal, maybe also a little bit buggy, and it doesn't seem like it improved too much. It's also not very customizable. So for example, if you want to change the font or the font color of your navigation titles, the background color, this is not natively supported in SwiftUI. Or for example, I wanted to customize the behavior on the iPad, where the navigation view is like a split view for controller, and you can set for UI split view controller the behavior of the sidebar. So does it appear? Is it a slide over or not? And this I cannot do in SwiftUI. Last year they changed the toolbar, navigation bar items, to the toolbar, which is one reason why it works much better for the macOS, because whatever you put in the toolbar for iOS is going to go in the navigation and in the navbar items. And on macOS, it will go in the window menu. So you get some built-in customization depending on the platform. Then now we did get a small addition, which is badges. So you can have this little number attached to your tab bar items. This also works for list items. Then we also got with SwiftUI 2 the vSplit view, an hSplit view for macOS. And I also found that there's some views, overlay views, to show a dialog for exporting and importing files. So this is this file export and file import. Then there's the sheet, the full screen cover. The full screen cover just means all the view is covered and the user cannot pull it down to dismiss it, because this was for some people quite essential that the user needs to finish the action. And this year they added a new view modifier where you can, even on a sheet, you can set the interactive dismiss disabled to true, which means that the user cannot pull it down anymore. In this case, you have two options to do this, forcing the user to finish the action with full screen cover or with this interactive dismiss disabled. They also made it easier to work with alerts in sheets, because now in the alert, you don't need to use a alert view. You can now use normal SwiftUI views. And one of these overlays, they added a specific one, which is confirmation dialog. This is quite useful if you have the user wants to delete an item and you want to maybe ask them before you actually do it. So they need to confirm, you show this confirmation dialog. Are you really sure you want to delete this? So this makes it a bit easier to do this, but you can also use this with a sheet. The other thing that I realized in the section is that the navigation link did get all new initializers. I don't know why, but it's very annoying, because then I have to again check the version to use the right initializer, and they didn't change too much. It's just the way the order of the arguments changed. Then the next group of views is container views, so combining different views together in a container view. So one of the new ones last year was the scroll view reader, which helps to programmatically scroll to a specific view. And we also got a lazy H grid and lazy V grid, and lazy V stack, actually, a lazy H stack, which I didn't put in. Lazy means it's lazy loading, in contrast to H stack and V stack. So this is interesting if you have large amounts of data and you don't want the system to load all of these images. If it's lazy, it means it's only loaded when these views appear. This gives you the possibility to have multiple columns with a fixed number of columns. You don't get a flow layout, like I have here this flow layout style. Still didn't get this, because I have quite a few cases where I would use this. So in this case, I still have to go back to UIKit. This year's big update is the table views. So this is for macOS specific. For example, here in SF symbols, I can go for the list style. Now I have this alternating lists. Get also this inset list style alternatives background modifier to customize this. And it gives you also the possibility to have here this expandable rows and here also this sorting your list differently. They did show quite a nice demo about this in the DubDub presentation about macOS. Very important for macOS. This might be a necessary feature for people if they want to make a Mac app. Then we come to the list. I already said tables, but list is, everybody uses list at some point. And one of the nicest features is now that you can use a list with a binding. This is, if you have a list and you want to edit one of the items in the list, you couldn't do that so easily before. So this is a small example, and the difference now, you see here the list takes a binding. I then have here the binding to this property for each of these elements, and I can add here a text field to edit one of them. So this is actually pretty much the example they had in WWDC. So I can edit one of these elements, and I don't need to change the style that I had before, because basically I only need to add here this dollar sign for the binding. So this is really nice, and it's also backwards compatible to iOS 13. So I guess they really wanted this to be there. You can directly start using this. The other things for lists that they added is more customizability. So last year we did, for SwiftUI 2, we did get disclosure groups and outline groups. So this is nested folders, and we can hide sections. What they added this year is a lot of appearance things. For example, you can change the separator between two items in the list, the color. You can also say it's hidden. And the same as for separators between different sections, you can change the color. And you can also hide these ones. You can also add a header prominence modifier to increase, which means that the section header becomes bigger because they are quite small. There's more things coming for lists. So this was, I think, one of the biggest, this seems to be a big topic. I guess it's reasonable because everybody uses lists. there's more about interaction that I put in a different section down below with the gestures and interactions. Then we have the layout system, which is probably one of the things that people struggle with the most. You need to understand what SwiftUI is doing. So we did get a little bit of update. For example, there's the scene padding. And we also have a save area inset, which means that you can put some content in there. This is an example where you see a list. I did color the background of each of these items separately. Actually, I have here a scroll view with a for each. And just to see the effect, I also added here different backgrounds depending on the raw. The interesting thing is after the scroll view, I added a save area inset. And you have here the possibility to add a content at this inset. So I chose to put it at the bottom. You can also put it on the top. And I added here this material background. You can decide if it's thin, ultra thin or thick. So it shines a little bit through. And the nice thing, the important thing about this save area inset is if I scroll down to the very last, I can even scroll to the very last, it still lets me scroll to the end, because sometimes if you put it on top, there are some elements that would be below. And I don't really want this. I want this to slide behind it. And I quite like the effect of this materials. Actually didn't realize how nice they can be. So now that we have seen some of the newer features for composing view tools, there's some updates for static views or views that actually are the content of this container views. For example, the text did get a few updates. There is markdown support. This is especially interesting if you have links. So for example, you could put in a text a link, a deep link to another app or another website, so it could send the user to different places. They also added, which I didn't put in here, some nicer ways of formatting dates and list elements, arrays. Then we have the label that we got last year. The second big theme this year, I guess, was more styling options. So for example, buttons, you can now add more button styles. So they per default have some bordered button styles. You can also give your button a role, which then the system decides which platform you ever run on, decides how it's displayed. Last year, we did get the link button. So you can press on a button and it opens the URL, the website in a different view. Similar this year, they have this for asynchronously loading an image. So you just need to give it the URL and it loads the image. So this is probably even nicer if you have lists that include images, so you don't need to do so much work by yourself. The other thing that they improved quite a bit is the system icons. You get colored icons and they can be also multicolored, so they have some depth. So this is the symbol rendering mode view modifier, so you can have different layers. If you choose multicolor, the symbol uses the color that it provides. Some of them don't have color, like the stack on the right. The trash is therefore always red, which is quite convenient. So you don't need to think about the color anymore if you want to use just the system provided ones. You can also use palette and then color the different layers to your liking. For example, this button is, you can really color them in your custom colors if that's what you need. And for this coloring layers, this is this foreground style that helps with this. So then you can decide, give multiple colors, which is used for different layers. You can also now use icons and text. That's quite nice. Like here, this small icon that is in the middle of the text. Then they have some symbol variants. So for example, the difference between this and this folder is that one of them is filled. So instead of defining it inside these, naming it directly in the image view, you can also add another view modifier, which is this symbol variants, and add the fill in there. So you can also add fills to stacks, to container views, and then all the fill is applied. In some cases, the system also changes them. So for some of them, for example, they said that in iOS they are not filled. In iOS they are filled in the tab bar. So the tab bar would look like this, and on macOS they would use the stroked variants, the outline ones, or the top ones. They have quite a few of these variants, so you can also use the square filled ones, the dashed ones in some cases. You already saw this background with these materials in one of the examples. Then we also get the control prominence. Prominence means if you add this, for example, to a button, it just becomes brighter. You can also change the size of these control views. So they have small, medium, and large. For iOS, you cannot do it, use a small one because I guess with the touch, it's otherwise too small. But for macOS, you can make it smaller. And really on macOS, you see the differences because it's more supported. Then there's also some reduced view modifiers that hides the underlying information. And they also added this year the privacy sensitive view modifier, which means that if the device is in locked mode, like for the watch, it's also redacted until you unlock it. So nobody can read your messages until unlock your device. So all of this is more small. I mean, most of the styling here is more small improvements, but they are probably nice for just to make the look of the app more interesting and maybe even help with the user experience to highlight certain things in your app, what they're supposed to do first, what's the primary action. There's a lot more view modifiers, I guess. Then if you don't want to use a system icon, you don't want to use an imported icon, you can also use drawings. This is based on paths and shapes. So for example, you can also use this to draw, but you can also cut out other elements with mask shape, for example. You can stroke and fill this. And this year's new is the canvas view. An example for the canvas is to make a little drawing app. So in the center, I have this canvas where I get the context, and I have, in order to draw something, I have to tell the context to stroke, for example, a path with this color and this line width. And here I added a gesture, a direct gesture, to check where I actually touch. Then I add these points to my lines that I keep track of. I need to remember where I actually touched. And these lines I'm then using here to create these paths. So when I here touch my canvas, my drag gesture recognizes this, adds to the line, and my canvas uses the context to draw this. It's very small compared to what you would need to do in UIKit. You can also do some undo and delete function by simply deleting these lines or setting this array of lines back to zero. One of these lines structures consists of an array of the points. Then I also have the color of the line, and you can also use this to store maybe the opacity or the line width. So you can very easily make a drawing app with this. Or you can also, instead of creating a path and drawing the path, you can also draw icons, images, or text. So it's a very nice little view. Especially if you want to do some animations, you can also add this together with some timing. So you can change the drawing over time. One thing that helps to do the animation with the canvas is to use the timeline. So this gives you a timestamp, so it's periodically calling the function disclosure to create your views inside. So you can periodically update your UI and say, okay, after 1 second, this view goes here. After the other second, this animates there, it becomes bigger there, and then start all over again. So you can do some fancy animations that are not just repeating from one value to the other, but really different steps in between. In SwiftUI, the animations are you can do some very advanced animations with little code, but you need to understand some of the basics. And so last year we did get the progress view. So this is, for example, activity indicator, style, one of them. And we get the match geometry effect. This is for hero animations. But it doesn't work for any of the navigation views or popovers. So it's a little bit of a limitation there. Then the UI control views. This kind of views, I was expecting to see more updates. So for example, last year we did get the color picker and the map view. Although with any of these, you don't get the full control. Also, we did get the text editor, but this only works with strings and not as attributed strings. So if you want to make a rich text editor, doesn't work so well. The view, okay, it's actually here a view modifier, but this is a search text field. This is a searchable view modifier. For example, you can add this to a list. So I have here a simple list, and I added this searchable view modifier, and this is basically a text field. It's mainly a text field, but you get these nice animations and also here this icon and a cancel button. What I also added here is some search suggestions, so you can also, you don't need to, but you have the possibility to say, okay, I want to show this item, and if it's completed, then my search text or whatever I bind here gets this value. So if I press here on the apple, I'm using this apple text field. The other thing that I anyway have next in the list is this, the roadmap is this onSubmit. So this is personally, I think, one of the biggest one, probably my favorite update this year is focus management. So this closure here is called when I select, when I finish here the action in my search field. For example, if I press enter as the user, this closure is called, or if one of these suggestions I'm selecting, then this is also called, so you can then start fetching or updating. It gives you really good feedback of when to start your expensive calls. You can put this to text fields or text editors, and whenever somebody presses enter, then this closure is called. This onSubmit label is, you can change the button. So I have here some other examples, which highlights here some of these features. So this is for text fields with focus and submit management. And this text field, I did add this onSubmit label with the done action. So this is in German. That's why it's not done, it's fertig. You just need to specify with this enum type which of this action this is supposed to be, and it also localizes it correctly. If you don't want to have, for example, I have here four fields. If you don't want to have this submit on submit call for one of them, you can add the submit scope modifier to one of them, and then it's not called. This gets even more interesting when we have a look at how to do the focus management. So this would be a new kit, the how to deal with the responder chain. They did add some modifiers last year, which is focused value, focused binding, and focused at focus value. I tried to use this, but I didn't really succeed, I would say. And looking at the discussion at the Apple developer forums, I think it seems like their first attempt to handle focus correctly failed. But this year they seem to have put a lot of work into it because it's working very nicely. So for example, in this case, I can here also to, you see here these two buttons, which I added in the toolbar. Probably should show you this. You can also add with this toolbar modifier, a toolbar item group, and place it just above the keyboard. So I only added this here to my last text field, but it's also appearing for the other four. And I have here two buttons. Let's just see what they do. So it's arrow up and arrow down one. And if I press on them, I can move focus between these text fields. So maybe it does not seem super amazing for this case, but if you put this toolbar, if you combine these toolbars with keyboard shortcuts, like on the macOS, that's extremely powerful. And even on iPadOS, if it's going to be a more productivity tool, then definitely keyboard shortcuts and focus management should be included. And now you're able to do this very easily with this focused modifier. So this is focused state. So you have to define a add focused state property. This has to be optional because if it's nil, then nothing is in focus. And I have here three cases. So I simply need to add this focused view modifier to this text field and say, okay, if this property is equal to title, then this text field is in focus. For the second one, I have to obviously have here different equal to. If the focused field property is equal to body text, then this one is in focus. Which means because this is a focus state, you can also programmatically change this. And this is basically what I do with these two buttons here. I'm just saying for moving focus downwards, I'm checking what is the current focus, which of my text fields currently in focus. If it's the first one, then move it to the next one. And I'm just moving it to the last one. And the last one here, I'm setting this to nil. So just go down, I'm navigating further down. So if I press down, I'm setting this to nil. And this will automatically dismiss the keyboard. So now you also have a way of dismissing the keyboard. And to show another example of where this could be useful, I mean, okay, probably everybody knows some cases where it's useful, but now I'm showing you that it can be done. So this is, I'm just trying to rebuild one of the examples from the WWDC. Presentation was direct and reflect focus in SwiftUI. So I have here this nice material background again. So this is basically just a background. So in order to get this background, this blurry background, you can add a background with a regular material. In this case, I chose a rounded rect shape. So this can be also thin material or ultra thin. And now it becomes even more blurry. But I thought maybe so you can see more details of the background, but I guess this is too much in this example. probably should first show you what I made here. So you can, and you type B, C, D, E, and if I press here enter, I can allow it to jump to the next line. If I'm not happy, for example, if this is not really an email formatted, I didn't really do this properly right now, and I try to press here enter, I'm not going there. So I'm using one of these onSubmit. Here it is onSubmit, because this is every time called when one of these views that is inside the stack where I'm adding this, this is called, and I can check, are you good with the email or not? So this is actually also what I'm doing here. Just validate if it's fine. If it's not fine, then the focus field should stay the same. And if this is good and my password is empty, then I'm moving to the next one. So you just need to type in here more. So now you don't see the red border anymore. And if I press now enter, I go to the next one. Some numbers. And now if I press enter, I can dismiss the keyboard. This is here, this focus, and I'm probably should also, this is also the moment where I should start my loading action. So with this, you can decide if something goes wrong or let the user go there, or you can, if you created a new element and you showing a new view and you directly want to bring one of this field into focus, you can also do this. The other thing that is interesting, which I cannot properly prototype because this is more for Mac and I didn't install the new macOS Monterey. But for example, just going to show you here in the SF Symbols app. So here I have one of these items in my list and I would want to have a keyboard shortcut doing a specific thing. What you would do is add it to the command or to the menu, which is commands, which I didn't really talk about. So you would have here a new item in your list. What they use this here is, for example, for this new collection, which is empty. Try to delete it, and the only way to delete it is here under edit, they have now the delete option. So I don't think it's, if I select here one of the standard ones, this delete is disabled. But for the new collection, they enabled this. So you would need to have a communication between your main window and the menu items that you have, because this one needs to know if something is selected. That can be deleted. And also when I press here delete, somebody needs to actually delete it. So I would need to, in this case, maybe send a notification or directly delete it there. So this stuff of what is in focus, because maybe I have multiple windows, which one is the one in focus that has something selected, that can be deleted. So you need to know a lot. And that's why they have here this focus scene value. So you can have more advanced communication between your window and your menu, for example. You can also define if a view should be able to be focusable. You can also have a view modifier saying if a view becomes into focus, I want to do something. So there used to be a text for the text field. This is the Xcode documentation, and I just searched for text field. So here they have one which is on commit and is editing and on commit, which they, I guess, did not properly change. This is decorated. So, and if you look at it, they said I should not use this submit and on focus. Because on editing changed is now similar to this on focus. It's the same time that it just happens. Either it's in focus or I'm changing something, I guess. And the other thing is the on submit. On submit is means somebody pressed enter. That's the same as on commit. So that's why you just, you know, have to exchange this type of text field with a normal text field and on submit and on focus. So there's a lot of things you can do with this focus management, which probably is not so important for iOS. Okay, you could drop down to UIKit to do this first responder chain, but especially with macOS, I think this is a huge improvement and you can make some very nice workflows. Also for tvOS, because there it's the main way of navigating that you have to be able to with the control decide which views are now in focus. So then there's a lot of gestures. You saw one gesture that I demoed, which was the drag gesture to door. But some of the capabilities they improved is interacting with lists. So we had the on delete, on move, and on insert, and they only work for each inside a list. And also you can only move things inside one for each. I don't really like this. The new thing is a swipe action. This is an alternative to on delete, because when you do onDelete, it only has one action call, delete. And with swipeAction, you can define what items are displayed. Here I have a list with just two implementations. One is onDelete. So this is the first three elements. And if I swipe, you see here this delete button. It also supports full swipe. And in case you don't want to just have a delete, or you don't have a for each, because this is the other reason why you might want to use swipeAction, you can add multiple buttons here. For example, here I have a button with a green, a destructive button, so it's some button examples, and one button that is this blue button here. They are in the opposite direction because I said it's trailing. You can also support if the last one, or the first one in this case, is the full allow full swipe. So that's why you saw the green one here, the one to stop coming up fully. You can also decide instead of coming at the trailing side, at the bleeding side. One thing to do is, for example, you have one list item that you want to highlight or make a favorite, mark or edit. But the thing is, you know, you have to decide if you want to use a swipe action or on delete, depending on what's more convenient. It's just one more way of improving your lists. So this is the swipe action, and also there is the pull to refresh, and I guess this was one of the most important. Some people really wanted this. You can add this to a list, and you have here the possibility to do some asynchronous work. So this works with async. In this case, I'm not loading anything, but you see it here. As long as I pull down, the animation goes. So it's nice and interactive. It's interesting they choose to use async, which makes it harder to use it with combined data streams. I'm not really sure why they choose this, because you could have also have here property that you can take care of, a state property saying if it's loading or not. So for example, having here a, that would be the alternative, then you had this in state. So every time you would pull, this would switch to true. Maybe I should put this false. Uncomment this. The difference in this implementation is that if I pull down, I would have this is active would have been true, which I then could use to trigger in my view model a data stream with combine, or just a, in the sync, you can also start some fetches. So it would be easier to start a data stream instead of, because with this refreshable using combine, I'm not really sure. The other advantage of this implementation would have been that you could programmatically show this loading state, because if it's just state property, and maybe your backend suddenly receives data that you want to let the user know that you're actually doing something currently, then you could also do it by setting this here to true. So it would not only start loading just in animations when the user pulls it down, but also when we set it to true, when we receive the notification from our backend that something updated. But I choose to implement it with this refreshable async call. The refreshable and the task are both the two situations where you see async await. So it's going to be interesting how they are continuing their design. Is it going to be more declarative, what I hear proposed, or are they going to go for the newest, nicest feature, which is async await? So this was pull to refresh. The other interactions is on drag and on drop. They were added in iOS 13.4. Then the thing that they changed is you can now change the preview. So what is the icon that you're appearing to drag around? It's just a little bit nicer animations. I did not, from the property wrappers, so I'm not talking too much about this data model. From the property wrappers, they did add this at focused state. But I guess it's because last year they did such a big update on this. And that was actually probably the biggest improvement for SwiftUI 2 for me, which was the state object. Otherwise, it's really hard to make a big project. As a summary, they added a lot of customization to lists. So how they look and how you can add new behaviors like this refreshable, this searchable, the swipe actions. The second biggest improvement and my favorite is this focused management. And then we got a lot of this small, making it nicer and making it look nicer. So this is all this, the canvas and the drawing and the async image, the customization with the stylings, the system icons, and just highlighting which actions to do first for the user. Don't try to overdo and go have a look at all of them. Just have a look at, maybe you found something that I showed you that you like the most. Just have a look at some implementations of this. I'm going to publish some tutorials about my favorites, like this focus management and the lists and this drawing. So you can also see how I make this drawing app. I'm going to make a small series of making one small app with where I try to use all of this, well, not all of this. Where it makes sense, I'm going to use some of these new features, and specifically here, this lists and this focus management, and maybe also this styling things and this canvas, because it's more fun to actually build something with it and use it. So subscribe to this channel if you don't want to miss this, or maybe it's already published and you can have a look when you're watching this. I hope this was helpful, and please leave a like. Until next time, happy coding.